Hi and welcome. In this video, I will give an overview of all authentication methods which are used to authenticate a user before he is granted access to an information system. I will also discuss different attacks against these authentication methods and what all mitigation controls we can put in. The first type of authentication method is something you know, and it is also called type 1 authentication method. For example, something or some password you know, and it is the easiest but weakest to implement. Second type of authentication method is something you are in possession of, for example, any physical token or a smart card. The third type of authentication method is something you are, that is your physical characteristic or biometrics. The fourth type of authentication method is based upon some place from where you are accessing the information system. For example, your IP address or your GPS location. There are certain other type of authentication method, for example, something you do or something you type on the keyboard and how you type it or how you sign your name. Then coming over to the something you know or type 1 authentication method, there are four types of password. And the first type is the static password, and this is most common and used over web application. And it does not change or changed after a long period of time. So the second type of password is one-time password, which you use only one time and you cannot reuse it. And the third type of password is basically a passphrase, and it is a long sentence you can use. For example, this is my password. And the fourth type of password is the dynamic password, and it requires a physical or a software based token code to authenticate. So basically you combine the password with this code which you get through this token device, and therefore it requires two factor, that is something you know and something you have. So there are certain kind of attack against something you know, and the first attack is the password guessing attack. And basically password guessing attack is an online password cracking technique, and it is mostly used to crack the web application passwords, and it does not require that you should have the possession of password hashes. So there are certain measures or the controls which can detect these password guessing attacks, and these are the fail login logs which you can monitor, or you can set a clipping level of certain number of password tries, after which it will give an alarm to the admin of that web application. So you got to appropriate, or you got to set this clipping level to allow access to the legitimate user, or to reduce the false positive or false negative, that is falsely accepting the wrong user or the malicious user, or falsely rejecting the legitimate user if he forgot his password. So it should not be too strict or too loose up. And you can lock out these kind of accounts from where these tries are monitored, and then it requires help desk support to the user in order to reopen this account. And attacker can also launch DOS attack or denial of service attack by locking out the accounts of legitimate user. So another mechanism you can implement is you can set up a reset time, for example, of 30 seconds or 1 minute. After that, user can try to log in again. So second type of technique against something you know is password cracking attack. And this password cracking attack is basically offline technique where you gather the password hashes of a victim system, and after that you try to crack these hashes by launching the dictionary attack. And the packet storm security is provides these dictionaries, and basically these are the list of the possible password, and then you can use this chain enable tool to crack these password. Or you can launch a brute force attack by trying all possible passwords, and it requires a lot of system resources. So one technique you can put in is the use of salt. So you combine this password and then this salt, which is a random value, to produce a random hash every time the password is put into the system. So instead of getting one hash for one password, you get multiple hashes against one password based upon the salt length. So these are the basically the location on Linux system where these password files or hashes are stored, and on Windows system, that is the security account manager, same file. So these files are basically stored at domain controller, or they can also be get controlled or get stored on local system on Windows. Then this LM basically, or the LAN manager, which is a Windows based technique to store hashes, password hashes, basically this LM converts all password into capital letters, and after that it create a hash value. And anti-LM does not do that, so it is more secure. And basically Linux adds this salt value with the password, and in the previous system of Linux or Unix, this salt value was of 16 bit. So there are actually these number of combination against single password hash value, and this functionality is not available in LM or anti-LM, that is Windows. Now an attacker can gather the hash value from the system memory, or it can sniff over the network, and these are the tools he can use to sniff these values, these password hashes. Then what is recommended is that you use at least 8 character for your password, and you use a combination of special character, upper and lower case of alphabets and numbers to create a strong password. So basically this brute force attack tries every combination of a password, and it basically use the GPUs, which are multi-cored, to try to brute in or brute force a password. Then these Rambo tables are pre-calculated hashes of the password, and basically they reduce the redundant work required by the CPU, so they increase the efficiency of the password cracking system. And then there is a trade-off of the time and memory in implementing these Rambo tables, because they require a lot of time to generate the Rambo table initially. Then there is a hybrid approach. Basically it is used to crack the complex password. For example, if a password is using or replacing this O with zeros. So these are the guidelines for password security in Microsoft system, and these are given by the Department of Defense. These are the baseline or the minimum threshold of passwords. Now coming over to second form of, or second type of authentication method, that is something you are in possession of or something you have. So there is the synchronous dynamic token, which can be a physical token or a hardware based token, and it uses two techniques to create a token value or a token code. First is based on the time syncing, and second is based on the counter sync. So time sync value basically changes the code on a physical device or physical token after each minute. So after each every minute, you get a new code, and this counter based is based upon the counter. So after using one code, the physical token that you are in possession of gives you another code. So basically, first of all, I'll explain what is this. So basically, this is the time. A hardware based time synchronized dynamic token. So basically this is a physical device which is synced with the server, value is synced with the server. So after every minute, server updates its value, and this device also updates this value after, and these devices require initial syncing with the server. Afterward, these are independent. And this device is with the user, and this user combines his password with this token value or code, which is generated after every minute to log into the system. So this is time synchronized, not counter synchronized system. So actually it uses the user name, then his serial number, which is over here on the device, and then the time. So this system use three parameters to authenticate a user, and this can be also a software based. So this Google Authenticator is a software based token. So this token can be synchronous or asynchronous. So asynchronous basically challenge, once the user tries to log into a system, then the system challenge him with a value. Then the user insert this value into this physical token or software based token, and this device then runs an algorithm and to generate a random value. Then this user insert this random value along with his password to the authentication system. So this is the entire mechanism. First the user tries to log into this server. The server challenge him with a random value. User insert this random code into the physical token or hardware or software based token. Then the token runs an algorithm and generates a random value. Then the user insert his password plus this random value into the system, and the server then checks and runs its own algorithm to validate the original value or the correct value. Then the third type of biometric is control is the biometric, that is your physical characteristic. So that basically bio means life and metric means measurement. So it checks your physical characteristic, this authentication system. So these characteristics can be your facial recognition or your fingerprint, then your retina or iris scan, or your hand geometry. So this facial recognition system checks the unique distance between different features on your face, and this can be it can be used to basically detect or to identify an individual. It cannot be used to authenticate because it gives so much false positive or false negative. So this system can be used to detect any suspected terrorist, or this can be placed in casinos to check any cheater. And this is basically a form of deterrent control, some people say that. And the second biometric system is the fingerprint, and this is basically used to authenticate a user, and this can be put in into your smart card, or this can be on your any smart keyboard where you give this fingerprint of yours in order to log into the system or to unlock a screen. The third type of is the retina scan, that actually checks the blood vessels in your eyes, and basically it reveals or leaks the health information. For example, if you are pregnant or you have a diabetic patient, so it is quite intrusive to the people, and it also is not considered a healthy system because there are chances of fluid exchange between different people. And the third type is the iris, or this is also based upon your eye scan, and basically it takes the photograph of the colored area of your eye, and it is a passive system, and it is recommended because it can scan through lenses or glasses, and it does not require to exchange any fluids, and it is very accurate system. So it is recommended to use iris scan instead of retina scan. And another authentication or biometrics based authentication method is the hand geometry, which basically checks the width, length or thickness of your hand, and it can store very small data, for example 9 bytes. Then another form of biometric system is your speech, that is how you speak a specific phrase or a sentence, and it is prone to replay attack, that an attacker can play your recorded voice in order to get authenticated on your behalf. So you can use random phrases in order to avoid this attack. And there is also one vulnerability that if you are ill, then this system may get failed. So biometric system, you cannot forget your biometrics because it is on you. You cannot change these biometrics and you cannot misplace these biometrics, which is the case with something you have, that is your any smart card. These systems are more accurate, but there are privacy issues and psychological issues, and then the health issues with retina or fingerprints, which you have to cater for. So enrollment should, the process of registering your biometrics should require a maximum of 2 minutes. And once you registered with this system, then if you want to authenticate, then it should require up to 10 minutes or 10 seconds or 6 to 10 seconds. And it is called the response time of the system of throughput. Then there are certain errors in these biometric system. First is the false rejection rate, that you are falsely rejecting a legitimate user. And then the type 2 error is the false acceptance rate, that you are falsely accepting a malicious user, and this is a more dangerous attack. Then there is the overall accuracy of the system, and it is called the crossover error rate or equal error rate, where these false acceptance or false rejection rates are equal, which is over here. So this is the maximum false acceptance rate once the sensitivity of the system is very high, very low. So once the sensitivity of the system is very low, then it is accepting the illegitimate or non-authorized user. And once the sensitivity is very high, then it is falsely rejecting the legitimate user to the authentication system or to the information system. So there is a threshold value you can set in where these two errors are equal, and this is the overall accuracy of this system. Then these are the certain characteristics from your fingerprints, that is your bifurcation, ridge ending, core and deltas. Over here you can see these characteristics from left to right. Then the fourth type of authentication method is at some place you are accessing from the system from. And basically, this is your GPS location or the IP address of this machine or the point of sale location from where you are trying to purchase something. And this is basically used to detect fraud by the credit companies. So if a user is at a location where he is not supposed to be, then these companies reject the user the access to the his account. So you have to inform before travel to any abroad location. Then another type of attack is something you do, for example, your habit, pressing the keyboard. This is very cheap and very effective, but it can prone to impersonation. And another one is how you sign your name. Then you have to use multi-factor, that is, in order to counter yourself from replay attack, that is replaying your credentials or password, for example. So you can use the combination of PIN and ATM card or smart card or your fingerprints. And this is a more secure form of authentication method. So this was all from my side. This is my channel. If you like my effort, please stay connected to my channel. Thank you.